是彼此依恋。Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship your holy name. Sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing your song, my soul, worship his holy name. Worship your holy name.
Hey,
you're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. For all your goodness I will keep singing on. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praises unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your you. God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you
Kindness, don't ask for much, but an open mind. Kindness,
cure a broken heart. Honey, are you feeling kind? You're so kind, can you let down your head? Will you try and understand when it goes wrong? Days come and gone, and it's been said and it's been done. I will shelter you with my love and my forgiveness. But an open mind. Kindness can cure a broken heart. Honey, are you feeling kind? Do you believe in love?
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Downtown Disciples. We are a progressive faith community doing justice, loving kindness, and walking humbly together. We are LGBTQIA+ affirming. We proclaim Black Lives Matter. We say that every time we gather because it matters to speak the liberating, empowering, justice-making good news of our God that we know in Christ. My name is Debbie Griffin. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. It is such a joy to be with you on this gorgeous morning. Thank you for coming out to worship with us. And thank you to Rhonda Mickelson for blessing us with music. A couple of brief announcements. This morning we tried something new. We had a 9 a.m. worship service for anybody that feels like it's a little warmish by the time noon rolls around. And that was an intimate, lovely service, so we might be trying that again. We might bump it to 9:30, because it seems like that still gives us enough time to get everything set up for 11 o'clock service. So just to let you know, that was went well, and we'll probably be trying that again at least during the summer. And, you know, we can always add the 5 p.m. worship back in. However, it's not very cool at 5 p.m. in the summer either. So we might need to save that for when we get back to Lamy. And next week is Pride Worship. Woohoo! All month long has been Pride Month. We're doing Pride differently this year because of pandemic. But aren't we blessed to be able to get together? And so next week, Pride Worship will be in this location, because turns out, even though the winery was kind enough to offer us their space, you can't get to their space next Sunday because of the Ironman competition. So all the streets are going to be closed. So we'll be here, and we know where this place is, so that's great. And you can see Kim blessed us by setting up a tent there. So if there's folks that need a little more shade, you're welcome to go in the tent. I think it's going to get more and more shade as the morning goes on. We'll probably bring a couple of those next week that we can spread around to provide more shade. Trinity Las Americas is also going to be worshiping with us. And Callie Wilson, who was a voice finalist and is from Iowa, will be leading our music. She and her wife are coming in all the way from Nashville. So we're excited to have them with us. And seems like there was one other thing I wanted to tell you about. Oh, parts of the worship, not the entire worship, but parts of the worship will be in Spanish and English next week, so that will be exciting as well. And oh my goodness, I almost forgot, look what I'm holding in my hand. Jennifer made these for us. They're so much better than the little scrap pieces of paper that are always blowing around all over the place. So you can find some of these on the table, and the sheets of paper are perforated, so you can tear them off for your prayer joys and concerns.
And
so,
then right on the back, you got a surface on the back to write on.
Yes, so it's not like you're trying to write on these things. So thank you so much, Jennifer. Also, we had amazing help this morning with our group that came to worship this morning, sorting through the beads. Mm-hmm. Last week, I promised that we would have materials to make beads during worship. You can make a prayer bracelet or something for your keychain or something to hang from your rearview mirror. Our text last week was from Acts, and we were reminded that after Pentecost, the people of God gathered together in one place. They had all things in common, so we wrestled with what the heck does that mean, to have all things in common. And they prayed together, they met in each other's homes, they ate bread and cup together, and this is how they created community. This is how they grew together and in their faith. So we're encouraging you to make yourself some beads or take beads home with you and make them. The supplies are up there, and some of your friends sorted them out for you. So yeah, so there is a look, there's slips of paper that invite you, if you're willing, to do a G for gratitude. So that when we pray, I just thought it would be neat if we were all kind of, not that you can't have a million ways to pray. Please do, right? But that we would know that one another's praying in this particular way from our homes and throughout the week. So G is for gratitude. So we give thanks. And R is for repent. So we confess the things that we wish we would have done differently, or the things we wish we wouldn't have said, or the things we wish we would have said, you know. And we hopefully turn in our ability to change that. And then O is for being open to the Spirit of God. So that might be, you know, be some quiet, some listening, some silence, being open into, you know, maybe somebody, the Spirit will put someone on your heart or mind to reach out to. Or maybe the Spirit will put a challenge on your heart or mind. But just to be open to listening. And then the W is for we and the world, and reminds us to pray for each other and for the world. So we invite you to make some prayer beads, G-R-O-W, and there's other things so you can make it all your own and be creative and do whatever you like. And feel free to do that during worship or take it home with you or both. So. And I think that's it. Unless, does anybody have any announcements for the good of the community? Oh, welcome Facebook friends. Thank you so much for being with us. We're so glad that you are here, and we're thankful that Liz is our Facebook host this morning and is chatting it up with you on Facebook Live. Please communicate with us. Let us know you're here. Let us know if you've got something for communion, what you brought for communion today out in Facebook world, and any prayers, joys, sorrows that you'd like us to be praying about this week. So now I'm going to invite us just into a moment of silence to rest in the presence of the one who loves us so much. Let us be still and know that God is God. Amen. And I'm going to turn it back over to Rhonda to bless us with song.
I think you know this one, so sing on.
What does Spirit require of us to do justice with love and kindness? In our hearts as we walk, humble in our talk, hand in hand, we can make it better. Yes, we can. What does Spirit require of us to do justice with love and kindness? In our hearts as we walk, humble in our talk, hand in hand, we can make it better. Yes, we can. We are a movement for wholeness. When the world falls to fragments, we are love and kindness in our hearts as we humble in our talk, hand in hand, we can make it better. Yes, we can. What does spirit require of us to do justice with love and kindness as we walk? Humble in our walk, hand in hand, we can make it better. Yes, we can.
I got messed up because I was listening to how good you said.
We are a movement for wholeness. When the world falls to fragments, we are one.
Jerry's going to come up and lead us. And I would like to invite somebody to go let the children know that it's almost time for children's message, because it takes them a little while to get from the park to here. So if somebody wouldn't mind, oh, Kiana, thank you so very much. And, you know, when we sing that song, all are welcome here, we also are saying all are affirmed here for who you are and who God has created you to be, beautifully diverse. Jerry.
Again, welcome. And isn't this a beautiful gathering?
Yeah.
You are a beautiful gathering. And I'll blame it on my age, but I'm going to be a little blunt here. I don't want you to be like me, which when it comes to singing, looks, walking, talking, you know, that's obvious. That's a given. But I don't want you to believe like me either. We don't all believe the same. And the reason I can say that is because each one of you, even before you were born, that spirit, the potter's hands was forming the clay of your being. And that same loving spirit has been working in you and through you and with you and despite of you all through your life. You might say that you are an incarnational masterpiece of the divine.
Yes.
Yes, you are. You're unique. And you're beautiful because the artist has created you with such love, with such mystery and wonder of his breath, of that breath, that spirit. So let's be open to that spirit as we join our hearts and as we join our voices in the call to worship. And thank you for being you, one in the spirit. Welcome to our affirming, joyful, faithful community.
We are one in Christ.
Let us celebrate our diversity, rest in grace, and love lavishly.
We are free in Christ.
Let us give thanks for this sacred space and this holy time.
Alleluia! We rejoice in Christ.
We delight in the glory of creation, the presence of friends, the gift of new faces, and the hope of this day.
We are creative in Christ.
Living Spirit, you are everywhere. You are more than we imagine. You are mystery and clarity, peace and power, love and justice. You are within us and around us.
You know us and love us.
Essence of everything. We open ourselves to the possibility of surprise, of silliness, beauty, repentance, and forgiveness.
We open ourselves to you.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Jerry. Now we come to a time of offering up our wonderings and our prayers, our offering something of ourselves, offering our gifts and our talents. And if the children would like to wait for me in that awesome tent over there, that would be spectacular. And I will be right with you. So as a community, like we studied last week from Acts, the earliest of Christians came together in all their glorious diversity, and they shared what they had. And they shared bread, if they had bread to share. They shared financial gifts, if they had financial gifts that they could share. They shared their time and their talent and their wisdom with one another. And that's what we invite you to do with us now, is to offer something of yourself to our community and help us create prayer together. So maybe you have a joy you can offer up, a birthday, an anniversary, some other celebration. Or maybe you have a sorrow, a grief to offer up. That could be, you could bear that burden easier if other people were carrying it with you. Now, our joys are greater when we share them. Our sorrows, our grief, and the injustice that we fight in the world can become easier to bear if we do it together. So we invite you to write on those amazing little pads that Jennifer made for us. And in a few moments, we'll come around with a basket, and I'll ask Jerry to help me with that. We'll come around and you can put in your offerings of your joys and your sorrows, your financial gifts. And those of you on Facebook, you can chat your joys and sorrows, and we will be lifting those up all week long as well. And Rhonda will just bless us with a little music to give you some time to think about your offering. And for those, we know a lot of our folks like to give financially to support our community, which we so appreciate, because we couldn't do it without that. You can do that also electronically on Givelify and on PayPal, or you can do it the old-fashioned way with a check. And believe it or not, we even take cash. So thank you for being generous and creating community with us and sharing your heart and your soul and your mind with us. Let us create prayer together.
Just fall on my skin. With all that you are, and rest on my shoulder. To fall.
coat to keep me safe and dry. But I need your grace in my life. I wanna feel the rain. I wanna feel the rain. I wanna lend and lend and bend. I wanna feel.
There were three wasps in that tent.
Oh, my.
Oh, my goodness gracious. I'm so glad. One wasp. Okay. Well, still, it probably seemed like three, you know. Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for being here today. And how, other than the wasp, was it a little shady in there, more so than here? Okay, next week we're going to bring a couple of different tents to give more shade to people. And are you all going to get in the water in a little bit?
Yeah.
You got your swimming suits on. I love it. I absolutely love it. You know, I think Downtown Disciples might be the only church in Des Moines where you can swim during worship, you can play on the playground equipment during worship. Even adults can do these things. You can sit in the shade in the lawn chair. You can kick back, take off your shoes, take a nap even. So we are so thankful to have this pretty, pretty park to do all those things, right? So I'm going to be quick because I know it's sunny and you're hot. I wanted to show you my beads. Do you all like to make beads?
Yeah, I made a bracelet.
Oh, you did? It's gorgeous. So you are welcome, because I know you're going to go swimming, so you don't want to make your beads now. But before you go home today, on that table back there, there's a bunch of beads, and there are some little cups with lids, so you can put the beads in the cup so you can take it home, and you can make a prayer bracelet or you know, it doesn't have to be a bracelet. It can be something you hang somewhere. And so I want to ask you a favor. If you will pray after you make your bracelet, maybe even every day, would you pray for our Downtown Disciple community? Would you do that? That would be so amazing. I can't tell you how happy it would make me feel to know that the children of our community are praying for us, that we would be all that God wants us to be, right? And there's some little pieces of paper over there too to tell you about these letters. So G can stand for gratitude. What are you thankful for? Gratitude means be thankful. Yeah? You are? So G is reminds us to give thanks when we pray. R is when we sometimes, it's called repentance. So sometimes we do things. Does anybody ever do something you wish you hadn't done? Like maybe you said something you wish you hadn't said. And so that's repentance, is when we say, I'm sorry, help me do better, right? And then O is when you're open to listening for God. And then W is we, praying for all of us, for the church and the world. Can you all do that? Should we pray right now?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll do I say, you say, and we'll do the G-R-O-W on our I say, you say. Okay? Will we make a circle? And you all are looking so amazing and sparkly, and you got your nails all painted. Everybody's looking so smashing this morning. I know. I love it, love it, love it. Woo, even glitter. Wow, it's perfect, perfect, and especially for pride, right? We're showing our glittery, sparkly pride. Okay, I say, you say. You ready? Okay. Loving God, we give thanks.
Loving God, we give thanks.
For friends.
For friends.
And cool water.
and cool water.
And playground equipment.
And playground equipment.
And parents and grandparents.
And parents and grandparents.
And our church.
And our church.
We're sorry.
We're sorry.
Sometimes we say things.
Sometimes we say things.
Or do things.
Or do things.
We wish we hadn't.
We wish we hadn't.
Help us do better.
Help us do better.
We are open to you.
We are open to you.
We hear you in the birds.
We hear you in the birds.
And in the quiet.
And in the quiet.
We pray for each other.
We pray for each other.
And the world.
And the world.
So everyone will know.
So everyone will know.
They are loved.
They are loved.
Amen. Thank you so much. Okay, have super fun in the water.
We will.
Okay, I know you will. I might have to join you after church, huh? Aren't they fabulous?
Oh, yeah. Did you see their expressions on their faces?
No. They are amazing, and we're thankful for people of all ages and for this diverse community. And now I invite us, we're on a sermon series of the early church, stories from the early church. What can we learn from the early church? Then it's my belief that they were a progressive faith community, a lot like us. So I think we have a lot to learn from them and to wrestle with. So we are doing Galatians, and we're going to be in Galatians for 5 weeks. Next week we have the most awesome text for pride from Galatians. It's like it was written for this, for pride. And but first we hear a bit about why Paul is so upset. So Paul is writing this letter to the church that he started in Galatia. And it's been a lot of years have gone by, and things have changed quite a bit. He writes this letter to them, and this is super embarrassing for the pastor. My Bible is on my phone, which is currently recording Facebook. And I did not print it out. I knew somebody would save me. Thank you. I knew someone would save me. I printed out the scripture for the 9 o'clock service this morning, but not for this one. So, okay, Jerry, you are a savior. See how we save each other. This is why salvation is communal. Okay, let us hear now this old story. Also, another little background piece about this is Paul and Peter had made an agreement. You know, they didn't know each other when Jesus was alive. Paul persecuted the Jesus followers. Peter was a Jesus follower. And but Paul and Peter have come to an agreement that Paul is going to be the preacher to the Gentiles, to the people that are cool about Jesus and they're Jewish, right? Or they're Gentiles, they're not Jewish. And Peter and the other disciples are going to be preaching and in community with the Jewish people who are cool about Jesus and want to follow Jesus. So they came to this agreement. They also agreed that the Gentiles would not have to be circumcised. So they would not have to become like everybody else to be in the community. And so that was going great for a while. And then Peter changed his mind because he got a lot of pressure from folks who were like, no, they should be circumcised. They got to be exactly like us. And so this is what Paul is upset about, is that Peter and others have been preaching to the Galatian church that he started in freedom and liberty and inclusivity, and now they're saying, no, you need to be like us. You need to do these things. So that's where we are. When Cephas, also known as Peter, came to Antioch, then I did oppose him to his face, since he was manifestly in the wrong. Before certain people from James came, Peter used to eat with Gentiles. But as soon as they came, he backed out and kept apart from them out of fear of the circumcision faction. You foolish people in Galatia, after you have had a clear picture of Christ crucified right in front of your eyes, who has put a spell on you? There's only one thing I should like you to tell me. How was it that you received the Spirit? Was it by the practice of the law or by believing in the message that you heard? Having begun in the Spirit, can you be so foolish as to end in the flesh? What I am saying is this. An heir during the time while he is still underage is no different from a servant, even though he's the owner of all the property. He's under the control of guardians and administrators until the time fixed by the parent. So too with us. As long as we were still underage, we were enslaved to the elemental principles of this world. But when the completion of the time came, God sent Christ, born of a woman, born of the law, to redeem us, to give us freedom so that we could receive adoption as children of God. You are children of God. And God has sent into your hearts the Spirit of Christ. And so you are no longer a servant. You are no longer oppressed, but you are a child. And if a child, then an heir by God's own act. Thanks be to God. I'm going to go back and pick up a couple more verses. Peter says, when I saw their behavior was not true to the gospel, I said to Peter in front of all of them, since you, though you are Jewish, live like the Gentiles and not like the Jewish people, how can you compel the Gentiles to live like the Jewish people? We who were born Jewish are not Gentile and have nevertheless learned that someone is reckoned as upright not by practicing the law but by faith in Christ, so as to be made in right relationship in Christ and not by practicing the law, since no human being can be found upright by keeping the law. Amen. Thank you. Let us rest in that for a moment of silence. Amen. We're thankful for that old story, been saved and passed on from generation to generation. May it come alive for us in our time and our place. So we just celebrated our 6-year birthday as an LGBTQIA affirming, Black Lives Matter proclaiming, progressing faith community, Christians in Des Moines. Now I'd like for you to time travel with me. Let's imagine it's our 25th anniversary. I'm old. Almost 80. I will be almost 80 when we celebrate our 25th birthday. So imagine it's our 25th birthday. I'm almost 80. I am retired. I have moved to be close to my grandchildren who have now graduated from high school. That's how long this will be into the future. One just had her second birthday, the other one's not even one. So that's what's going on with me. I'm hanging out with the grandkids who are by now are probably tired of me. I've been to their graduations. You have had two other amazing pastors since I retired. One, a queer pastor. One, a black pastor. Things have been going great at Downtown Disciples. You are growing. Some of our children are leaders in the community. It's going great. And now you have another brand new pastor who calls me up and invites me to come and preach in my old age for the 25th celebration. It's going to be a big shindig. People that have moved away are coming back. It's going to be so amazing. Of course I say yes. So I come to town a few days early so that I can meet up with some of you and chat about what's going on with you and your lives and get caught up on everything. It's terrific until somebody says to me, well, you know, a few things have changed. I said, well, that's okay, change is good. Well, some of the changes aren't so good. You see, now, in order to receive communion, you have to be baptized. And in order to be baptized, and not that there's anything wrong with baptism, we love baptisms. We've baptized several people. We love baptisms, but we don't require it. Right, for people to feast on God's love with us. We don't require something for God, for people to be able to taste God's grace, to eat and drink together. Jesus didn't require that when he sat around table with folks, right? In fact, some people called him a glutton and a drunkard because of the people that he ate and drank with. And they said, why are you always hanging out with those sinners? Right? So we have an open communion table, and our denomination has an open communion table. But I learned from some of you that now at Downtown Disciples, a person has to be baptized in order to receive communion. Not only that, but they have to recite the creed at their baptism. Now, there's nothing wrong with the creed. I am not saying there's anything wrong with the creed, and there's nothing wrong with reading the creed during worship, but that's not who Downtown Disciples was founded to be, right? We have agreed to disagree on some things, right? We have agreed that we are united in Christ and we have freedom in everything else, right? That we might disagree on some things that are in that creed, and that's okay, right? That we appreciate being able to wrestle together about the tenets of the faith. We appreciate that we can learn from each other and have disagreement. But now folks are required to confess the creed, to be baptized in order to have communion. Not only that, but now if you are single and or queer, you have to be celibate. Now, as you might imagine,
This is very troubling news for me.
For a lot of you. More so for you. I'm retired. That is what this letter to Galatians by Paul is about. What do you think my sermon is going to sound like that weekend at the 25th anniversary after just learning all of that? I think it's going to sound like Paul's letter to the Galatians. That's what I think it's going to sound like. I think it's going to be a sermon about liberty and freedom in Christ. I think it's going to be a reminder that we are free in Christ and affirmed in God's love, and that we are free to disagree. And that's actually how we learn and grow in our faith, is when we disagree and wrestle with the scriptures together. That's what's going on in Galatians. It is an intra-church debate. This is not a debate between Jewish people and Christians. It's a debate between Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. This is we're not talking about Christians being better than Jewish people or any of that. That's not what's going on here. This is an intra-church debate. And why is Paul so upset? Because Peter and some of the religious leaders, the people who were disciples, are now excluding people. That's what's going on. They're excluding people. They're saying, you're not welcome anymore. You're not welcome unless you become like us. You're not welcome unless you become circumcised. You're not welcome unless you follow the law in the way that we say you should follow the law, right? It's not that the Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians weren't following God's law. I mean, we remember Jesus said, I didn't come to abolish the law, folk. I came to live into it in a particular way. It's about how we interpret the law, the religious law. It's how we interpret living into the scriptures and how we actually embody it. We're not saying, no, you shouldn't love God and love your neighbor. We're not saying that. This is about how you love God and love your neighbor. And for the early Christian community, they looked to Jesus. His way was their way. That's how they lived into the law, in the way that Jesus did. So let's just remind ourselves of a few ways that Jesus lived into the law that were different from some of the religious leaders of his day. First of all, he ate with those drunkards and gluttons. He ate with people that other people wouldn't eat with. Jesus was inclusive. Secondly, he chose to sometimes break the law. So you know that sometimes he healed on the Sabbath. And you can heal on the Sabbath. The law allows for that. But some healings were not allowed on the Sabbath. If it was a healing of somebody that's been sick for a long time, the logic was, well, it can wait another day. Jesus is like, no, it can't wait another day. This person is suffering. We're going to heal them now. This is what it is to honor the Sabbath. It's to liberate people from all the things that bind them. Whether it's a physical illness or an emotional illness, whether it's exclusion or oppression, whether they've been told that they're not good enough, whatever it is, we're going to liberate them and we're going to do it on the Sabbath, and that's going to bring glory to God. This is how Jesus lived into the law. You remember that he let his disciples glean from the fields on the Sabbath day. He allowed them to work on the Sabbath. Jesus would interpret the scriptures in whatever way was most compassionate, what was most life-giving, and that's what this debate is about. Peter and some of the disciples have decided to interpret the law in a different way. And what Peter or what Paul is saying is this is not the way of Christ. Now, if you want to follow the law in this way, that's fine. Great. No problem. Go back and be with the Jewish community. We're not saying there's anything wrong with it. That's just not how it's going to be here. Because here, we are free in Christ. Here, we interpret the scriptures in the most compassionate and generous way, because that's the way Jesus lived into the law. So Paul is telling them that we place our faith not in a particular religious interpretation of the law. We place our faith in the faith of Christ. And Paul uses this language over and over again. Faith in Christ. Faith in Christ. That's how we save ourselves in the world. That's how God saves us, is by this particular liberating, life-giving interpretation of how we live together. How we have right relationship with God and each other and creation is we have the same faith of Christ. That little word in, faith in Christ, it doesn't mean to read a tract and say, yes, I believe in Jesus, and blah, 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 blah. It also can be interpreted of Christ. The way that God saves us is we grow in the faith of Christ. When we live in the way of Christ. When we speak the truth of Christ. That all are welcome and affirmed. That saves us from ourselves, from our isolation, from shame, from exclusion. When we work in the way of Christ. In eliminating racism and poverty, homelessness, and all kinds of oppression. When God is saving us from those things, it's the faith in Christ, the faith of Christ that saves us, not a particular religious interpretation of the law. And so we think to ourselves, well, what was the faith of Jesus? How can we have the faith of Jesus? Well, we can follow his way, right? We can take time to get away and pray and worship. We can speak truth to power. We can eat with beautifully diverse people. We can interpret the law in the most compassionate, inclusive way, like he did. We can heal the world of our divisiveness and our wounds. We can do justice as he did justice. This is the faith of Jesus. And then Paul reminds them, look, if we're not going to think that we're saved by the faith of Jesus, the communal faith that we do together, if we're just going to go back to doing things the way that they were before Jesus, then what's that mean about his death? How did anything change? If we are not going to embody the faith of Jesus, then are we not making his death meaningless? That's what Paul says. How can the faith of Jesus live if not in us? So, as people who call themselves Christians, we know that this is not, historically, people say, oh, this is the great debate about faith or works, right? That Paul's big into this. Faith, is it faith that saves you or works that save you? Or is it the faith that saves you or is it the law that saves you? I say, that's not the argument. That's not the debate. It's and. It's not faith or works. It's not faith or the law. It's faith and the law. The only problem is they got the cart before the horse. It's faith first. It's growing in the way of Jesus, the faith of Jesus, and trusting that the Spirit of Christ dwells in us and will guide us to the right interpretation of the law for our time and place. Because do you know the interpretation of the law was always changing? Because it's a living word. And times and place change. Faith first. And then the law. Faith informs our interpretation of the law. Faith informs our works of justice and mercy. And inclusiveness. So, you know what? Jesus didn't die for nothing. Because his faith still lives in you. And I'm not worried about 25 years from now. Because I'm not worried about the Spirit of Christ leaving this community. And I know good and well that if things start to be exclusive, not true to the way and the faith of Jesus, this community is going to rise up like Paul did. I'm not worried. Because it's about faith first. And you, I know, have the faith of Christ because I see it all the time in you. In the way you love and forgive and serve and include. In the way that you fight injustice. In the way that you feed the needs of the world. I am not worried. 25 years from now is going to be amazing, and I want it known that I want to come back and preach. Hallelujah. Amen. Jerry, would you come lead us in the prayers of the people?
Here we go. Please join with me. Saving love. We were created for connection. From our birth to our death, we need one another. We need you, your presence, your vibrant presence, power, wisdom, justice, and peace. In spiritual practice of prayer, we open ourselves to you.
Holy Liberator, free us from our fear.
In Christ, we come together, bringing our true selves. Here, we are safe to share our joy and sorrow, faith and doubt, despair and hope, anger and anxiety.
Holy Liberator, free us from our insecurities.
This is a place of play and laughter, picnics and soccer, water and wind. For all who gather in this park, live in the neighborhood, walk these streets, we pray, O Lord. May their homes, hearts, work, and play be full of you and of your love.
Holy Liberator, free us from our pain.
We experience your freedom in our flesh, in dancing feet and floating laughter, in breath to sing and speak.
Holy Liberator, free us from our body shame.
Thank you for dwelling in the beautiful diversity of our bodies. We celebrate dark and light skin, differently abled and sized bodies. You delight and dwell in soft baby toes and calloused old feet.
Holy Liberator, free us from judging ourselves and one another.
We are grateful for the many ways we experience healing. You heal us in the touch of a hand, sound of a word, and song of a bird. We give thanks for your healing manifested in medicine, science, herbs, and exercise.
Holy Liberator, free us from injustice.
We lament the oppression, violence, and injustice of our world. We need your wisdom and courage. Empower and embolden us to end racism. Engage in reparations. Create opportunity and equity. Make us devoted to hospitality. Open the borders, the flourishing of our neighbors, and the protection of the earth.
Holy Liberator, free us from despair.
Sometimes we place our faith in financial security, privilege, broken systems, and social status. Turn us again towards you and your way of peace. Hear and receive the good news. In Christ and in community, we are made new. Together, we are saved from isolation, hatred, shame, and despair.
In Christ, we are loved and loving. In Christ, we are forgiven and forgiving.
The affirming, empowering Spirit of Christ is alive among us. We rejoice in all the Spirit has done and is doing. For the dream of this affirming community made real, we give thanks. For Spirit empowering us to be bold in justice, generous in giving, and courageous in discipleship, we are grateful. Creating Creator, lavish love. We give praise for the ability to form community, for hugs and smiles. We thank you for those, here's one, I have a wonderful new partner. Praise and peace and joy. I have a tiny house, perfect for our needs. Prayers for an older family member working lots of overtime in this heat. Praying for a grateful and for growing relations. Let your love embrace us. God, in your mercy.
Oh God, we give thankfulness for being able to safely visit and hug loved ones. Gratitude for 32 wonderful years of marriage, Bryant and Jamie. Happy anniversary.
Amen.
That's right. We can clap here. Absolutely.
Oh,
yes. Good. Hallelujah. We pray for a government of and for the people, for compassionate change, for clear pathways to new beginnings. Someone prays for their home is in reach of being empty enough to sell. Woohoo! We pray for a family who struggles with basic needs of food and clothing. We have gratitude that God has provided some financial assistance to cover their rent, on an ongoing basis. We are so thankful for faith lived in flesh. We lift our prayers for speed and focus in emptying a partner's home. We are grateful for a new opportunity and work. Pray that God's goodness continues to be evident throughout an application process. And we pray for safe travels for someone's family. Oh God, we pray for all people who struggle with addictions and mental illness. Be their peace, and may they never be alone. May we be their comfort and their strength and their safe, sacred space. God, in your mercy,
receive our prayers. Make us your movement for wholeness in this fragmented world.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jerry. And now this feast that is open, this table that is open, where you are not only welcome, but you are affirmed as created in the image of God, who loves you, who created you as you are, and calls you to a life of faithful living in community with folks that love you and celebrate you, inspire and empower you to be God's love in flesh in the world. At this table, you are welcome again and again and again to taste that you are loved and you are forgiven and you are more than enough. So let us remember how Jesus often gathered together with people at table, and he didn't ask them what they thought or believed first before he gave them a cup and bread and invited them to share in his body. We remember the many times that Jesus made space for those who felt unwelcome. And we celebrate his open table by feasting and welcoming one another and those who have yet to find safe faith community. Let us remember how Jesus took bread, the gift of the earth. He blessed it, he broke it, he gave it to them, and he said to them, "This is me. This is my body, and I have given myself to you. I have given my hands to you in touch. I have given my feet to walk with you through good times and bad. I have given my voice to speak for you to those people in power. I have given my love and forgiveness to you. So do this. Do this with each other. And when you do, I am with you." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, the fruit of the vine, the gift of the earth, and he said to them, "This cup is a new promise, poured out for you, but not just for you, for the whole world, that we might be saved from ourselves. Drink of it, all of you, and know that you are loved." And we remember in Jesus' tradition, this was the cup they saved after supper. The one they saved for the Christ, for the Messiah, the one who would show them a way, who would show them a way of love and peace and justice, and would invite them to come along this way. That cup Jesus drank of, and then he gave it to all of them to drink of too, as if they too could do the Messiah's work in the world. As if they too could embody the Spirit of God. As if they too were called to do the Christ work in the world. "Drink of it, all of you," he said, "and be nourished for this call God has on your life." In just a moment, you'll be invited. All of you are invited. If you feel comfortable doing so, you can come forward and receive these adorable little chalices with grape juice and a gluten-free cracker in the bottom, because it is still pandemic And so we're not sharing common cup and common bread just yet. But we have faith we'll get there. We will get there someday. Until then, we have enough love for each other to be safe with one another. And for those of you at home on Facebook, we hope you have something delicious gathered to eat and drink, and that you will know that you are not feasting alone. You are feasting with us, and you are part of us no matter where you are. If you are comfortable doing so, won't you come, receive the bread and cup, take it back to your place, and feast.
I woke up with a broken heart in my chest. I couldn't sleep, couldn't get no rest. Weighed down by the heaviness of life. And I try to shake it, flipping through my phone. But all that does is make me feel more alone. Could anything that feels so wrong be right? 7 billion voices separate us. But only one can show us who we are. We are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of God. Made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. Yeah. We all need the same medicine. We all need another second chance. There's no first in line at the foot of the cross. Father, forgive me. Show my concrete heart. We are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. We fall apart. We all lose sight of heaven. But still, your love is chasing us. And oh, give me a heart for every heart that's breaking. And give me eyes to see. We're so much more than flesh and blood. We are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. Beautiful shades of love. We are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from. Yeah, we are made in the image of. Made in the image of God. That's where the light comes from.
It's been such a blessing to be with you. Thank you so much for bringing your spirit into this place. And for everyone that gives something so that we can be here, whether it's your time, your talent, or your treasure, we are so thankful because we can't do this alone. And now as you prepare to go out into the world in the faith of Christ, go in the peace, the power, the love, the joy, the silliness, and the justice of the one who loves you best. And may you be blessed to be a blessing. Amen. I invite you to enjoy the music.
Thank you.
how sweet the sight that saved someone like me. Was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. Precious did that grace appear. Yeah, I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already. His grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace.
Yeah, that's amazing. It's hard to write in these with your pen, you know?
Has promised good to me. His word, my hope restores. He will my shield and fortune be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing. Unending love, amazing grace.
Thank you.